there's a production going on in between us. Now, this production has light photons within it. So it's not absolutely empty, but you know, light photons, in terms of the spooky element of light photons, is the moment you ask a question, I vibrate. And no matter where the distance of our communication is, those particular photons are your first vehicle towards constructive emptiness. Do you understand? So emptiness of the mind then creates a mist in the body. The mist in the body then coordinates the photons externally. So the photons externally can then be manifested inside the body as hallways. These hallways are like parts or the pathways within your own temple. So no matter where you go within these hallways, you always honor this particular whichever pathway you go down, because everybody's a little bit different in terms of their primary personality. And it's the primary personality that they were looking for. So emptiness in terms of what truly is emptiness, and how do you move towards emptiness? I mean, that's your question, isn't it? Is that if I put my perception on the altar of my awareness, then I'm very, very responsible for what I add to the world and what I add to myself. So generally speaking, if you go to a therapist, the therapist will ask you what's going on with your emotions. They'll look at your emotions and say, I've got anger problems, I've got jealousy problems, I've got resentment problems, I've got this and that problem. This then is something which is a block towards realizing that there's a general stream of awareness occurring beyond these emotions. But the first step we have to take is to eradicate these inside of ourselves. I hope I'm not going too quick, because if I don't practice anger anymore, the way I don't practice anger, I cry. Yeah, because I don't want to get angry. I prefer to cry and unload my body in this way, because crying is the best way to relieve your body, because it's natural to cry. You can have false tears, and they test it, and the false tears have got the wrong neurotransmitters. You can cry honestly, and you'll have the right neurotransmitters, which cause transformation. Now, if you understand this fundamental truth, then crying from your heart center is the only way to enter you of the crisis which was within you. Otherwise, if you don't cry, you can talk constructively and deal with it. But what I'm really saying is that if someone's got anger or jealousy, if you don't practice anger, jealousy, then you empty yourself of these proclivities. Once you're empty of this, then the vehicle of communication of your sense of your body, you begin to become aware of something entering you. And most people say, well, Lujan, I'm confused. Is it me or them? And I said, the only reason you're confused whether someone's angry or you're angry is because you're still angry and you're still practicing anger. But if someone has anger and you don't practice anger anymore, it comes into your body. If someone's upset, it comes into your body immediately. So you read the person. Absolutely. So then you become a conduit of communication in terms of receiving really what that person is going through. And as it hits your body, you begin to understand who they are. So that's being of service. So once you're capable of realizing that you don't do these certain things, then you're capable of really talking to someone absolutely truthfully, because you've received them on your feeling center. But if you're confused about whether it's you or them, it's only because there's still an aspect of yourself that can't receive that information properly, because the process of putting the better part of yourself on the altar of your perception is to stop these things happening, so that you can actually commune with your fellow human beings in a way which relieves them of their pressure. And that's what we're meant to do, relieve each other of certain pressures, so we can evolve beyond the dilemma which is in front of us. And that's what's being of service is. And people get confused, well, I'll be of service. But usually the people who would be of service, they have to put aside everything to be of service to everybody. So they empty themselves by virtue of being of service. So emptiness is very obscure, because you don't know you're empty until you receive somebody, until you get pertinent information. It took me many, many years to realize I was parroting what people were feeling. And then maybe 30 years ago, when I realized this, I realized that that I have something of great value in terms of feeling what is being projected. And now it's very, very easy to discuss this. Maybe 30 years ago, it was very difficult, because the drama was, no, this is not possible. You cannot possibly get into my world with such precision so quickly. And this is the reality of our human condition. We should be able to do this. And if there's a restrictive idea that we can't do it, then that's really a bias that should be eradicated. So being of service, you put yourself aside. So if you still have emotions, you still put yourself at service, and then you watch the perception, which you can't control in terms of your reactivity. So if you're being of service and you have thought forms and feelings about the people you're being of service to, then you're not really being of service, because you're destroying yourself by having a bias towards them, because your perception is the first thing which occurs within your body. Yeah. And it doesn't really matter whether somebody else has put something there. It's a matter of how you sort it out. Because I believe that's the way you get to emptiness, by stopping all the processes which fill your room full of furniture. So you take the discernible furniture out, and it doesn't exist anymore until the room doesn't exist anymore. And when the room doesn't exist anymore, then you can't even see your full range of abilities. So then you fall into your fate at that particular point. But if your room is full of objects, then the objects determine your fate, because there is a limitation within that. And we're not limited. We're extraordinary as human beings. You know that when you completely love somebody, there is so much power that can be obtained when two people love correctly and responsively and responsible and in a responsible manner. And this love causes trust, and trust then turns off certain mechanisms, and then you begin to grow. And that's what we need in our society.